I would like for you to turn your Bibles, open up your Bibles, your electronic Bibles to Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. Come on, let me pray. Father, we do thank you for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy, O God. We thank you, God, for the praise and worship that has gone forth. Oh Lord, it's moved our hearts, God, in a magnificent way. We pray, God, that you've been pleased with our efforts to exalt your name. And so, Lord, we ask, God, as we delve into this word on this wonderful resurrection day, that you would give me clarity of thought and clarity of speech. God, that you would prepare each heart and mind to receive on today. And Lord, I know that you are a God of your word, and the promise of Scripture is that as the word goes forth, it will not return unto you void. Thank you, Jesus. In your great name, I do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Margaret Sangster Fippen wrote that in the mid-1950s, her father, British minister W.E. Sangster, began to notice some uneasiness in his throat and a dragging in his leg. When he went to the doctor, he found that he had an incurable disease that caused progressive muscular atrophy. His muscles would gradually waste away, his voice would fail, and his throat would soon become unable to swallow. Sangster threw himself into his work in British Home Missions, figuring he could still write and he would have even more time for prayer. "Let me stay in the struggle, Lord," he pleaded. "I don't mind if I can no longer be a general, but give me just a regiment to lead." He wrote articles and books and helped organize prayer cells throughout England. "I'm only in the kindergarten of suffering," he told people who pitied him. Gradually, Sangster's leg became useless. His voice went completely, but he could still hold a pen shakily. On Easter morning, just a few weeks before he died, he wrote a letter to his daughter. In it, he said this: "It is terrible to wake up on Easter morning and have no voice to shout, 'He is risen.' But it would be still more terrible to have a voice and not want to shout." On the count of three, right there in your homes, I want you to shout the good news of Resurrection Day, "He is risen." I want you to shout it so that your neighbors can hear it. 1, 2, 3, he is risen. One of the things that gives me the utmost confidence about being a follower of Jesus Christ is that the message of the most profound day of our faith has not changed since the first day. Amen. Listen to the record of the events as told through the pen of Mark. Mark 16:1 reads, "When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body." Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Who Mark identifies as a young man dressed in white, in a white robe, the other gospel writers classify as an angel. Just like in the day of Jesus' birth, an angel announces the good news that salvation has come to our world. Here, an angel is given the extreme honor of announcing that, yes, Jesus has indeed risen, just like he said he would. The angels encourage the ladies not to be alarmed, not to be afraid, because what he was about to tell them was news to be rejoiced and not feared. They had come to the tomb looking for Jesus, but the tomb was now empty.
Yes.
How many of you know that it doesn't make sense to look for the living among the dead?
All right.
Jesus is alive. Yes, the very one whom they crucified just a few days ago. The grave could not hold him. The grave could boast of a perfect record before Jesus came to earth. It was powerless to hold him, and he has risen just like he said he would.
Yes.
So the angel, who acted as the Lord's mouthpiece, was given specific, detailed instructions as to what to say. The angel could not choose his own words. He did not have that prerogative. He was directed by heaven to tell the women at the tomb to go tell his disciples and Peter.
Yes, yes.
Why does the Lord single out Peter? Why doesn't the Lord just say, go tell his disciples, or obviously automatically including Peter? Why does he specifically say, go tell Peter? What must Peter be told? Is it because Peter is the designated leader? Is it because it is Peter's job alone to tell everyone else? No, I don't think that those were the reasons. The Lord is much more personal, much more intimate, much more in tune with our psychological, emotional, and spiritual state than that. I can think of at least three reasons why the Lord singles out Peter. The first is that Peter needs to know that the Lord has not forsaken him.
Yes.
Turn back to the 14th chapter of Mark for a moment, which takes us back to a few precious moments before Jesus' arrest, trial, and crucifixion. Verses 12 through 26 is the record of the Last Supper that Jesus had with his disciples, in which he once again explains to them that he must be turned over to the authorities and he will suffer and he will die. Then check out the exchange between Jesus and Peter as I began reading at the 27th verse. You will all fall away, Jesus told them, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. I tell you the truth, Jesus answered. Today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times. But Peter insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the others said the same. Jesus lets them know that when the heat gets turned up on him tonight, that all the disciples will forsake him. But Peter makes a vow that he will never forsake the Lord. Peter promises that no matter what happens, he will always be Jesus's man. He will always be right by the Lord's side. Now, I believe Peter had good intentions.
Yeah.
I believe Peter was sincere about his vow. I believe that it was in Peter's heart to go to battle with Jesus. When Judas came to betray Jesus, accompanied by the chief priest's soldiers, Peter was the only one who was packing. Peter was strapped with a sword.
Yeah.
Peter was armed. Peter had armed himself with a concealed weapon, and he used that weapon. He cut off the ear of one of the soldiers. But Jesus would not have them fight for him in this manner. He healed the man's ear on the spot, and he willingly went with his captors. Now, Peter had the choice. He could stay right there with Jesus, mm-hmm. stay right by his side. He could have insisted to be arrested with Jesus, but he chose, like the others, to flee.
Yes.
He abandoned Jesus just like all the others, just like he vowed that he would never do. Mm. Peter had broken his vow to never forsake Jesus, and Peter has been carrying around the guilt and shame of failure for 3 days, and it's been eating away at him. Peter knows it, but more importantly, Jesus knows it.
Yes.
So Jesus sends word to the women to make sure they tell Peter. Jesus wants Peter to know that just because Peter forsook him, that Jesus still loves him.
Yes.
Just because Peter broke his vow, that Jesus has kept his. Mm. Jesus promised to rise again, and after that, he would meet them in Galilee. Peter needed to know that just because he left Jesus, that Jesus was not about to leave him.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
There's somebody today, just like Peter. You've been making promises to the Lord for a long time. You've been making promises to the Lord about your commitment to him.
Yes.
You promised the Lord that this year would be different. You promised the Lord that this year would be better. You promised the Lord that you would be a better person this year. That you would be a better husband, a better wife. You promised the Lord that you and he would be tight. You promised him that this would be the year that he received your very best. But it has not come to be. The Lord wants you to know this morning that just because you failed, it does not mean you are a failure.
Yes, thank you.
Just because you have left him, he has never left you. Jesus rose from the dead because you matter to him.
Yes.
He rose from the dead because he loves you, and it doesn't matter to him how many times you promised and broke that promise. He wants, he desires, he longs to have a relationship with you, and that relationship can have a fresh start today.
Thank you.
That's what the resurrection guarantees to you.
Yes.
It guarantees that you can have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Just like Peter, you need to know that the Lord has not forsaken you. So what I want you to do right now is I want you to tap yourself on your chest. And I want you to say, self, the Lord has not
forsaken
me.
Come on,
say it like you mean it. Self,
the Lord has not
forsaken me. Peter also needed to know that the Lord has forgiven him.
Yes.
Not only has the Lord not forsaken Peter, but the Lord has also forgiven him. After the guards had taken Jesus away, Peter had another opportunity to demonstrate his allegiance to Jesus. He had another opportunity to show Jesus that he will be with him all the way, no matter what.
Yes.
Look at verse 53 in the same chapter. It reads, they took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, elders, and teachers of the law came together. Peter followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. There he sat with the guards and warmed himself at the fire.
Yes.
The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death. But they did not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. They took Jesus to the high priest, and Peter followed them into the courtyard, but he followed at a distance.
Yes.
Peter was right there within eyesight of Jesus, and he knew exactly what was going on. They were looking for people to falsely testify against Jesus. They were looking for people to speak against him. Mm. Here is Jesus, standing alone, in need of a friend, in need of someone to speak on his behalf, in need of someone to counteract the lies that had been told. Mm. Who better to set the record straight than Peter?
Yes, yes.
Peter knew the truth. Peter had not long ago professed that Jesus was the Christ to the other disciples. Jesus commended him for that revelation because it came from his Father. Mm-hmm. Peter, having walked with Jesus for 3 years, having sat at his feet, having witnessed the miracles, now has a chance to make things right.
Yes.
He could have stepped up and spoken on Jesus' behalf. Mm. But when they were looking for witnesses, Peter remained silent. Then when he was questioned by some of those who were around him, he openly and emphatically denied that he even knew Jesus.
Yes.
He denied it with cursings. And with swearing of the tongue. Not only would he not speak up for Jesus to the high priests and elders, he refused to speak up for Jesus to anyone. Mm. Peter denied Jesus 3 times before the rooster crowed twice, just like Jesus said that he would.
Yeah.
Luke's account tells us that as soon as Peter finished cursing and swearing, check this out, Jesus looked straight at him.
Wow.
That's how close Jesus was to Peter. Mm. Jesus looked straight at him. He was close enough for the Lord to know that he was there and for the Lord to make eye contact with him.
Yes.
Look at Peter's reaction in verse 72 of this same chapter. It says, immediately the rooster crowed the second time. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken to him. Before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me 3 times. Mm. And he broke down and wept. Peter, having realized what he had done, was a broken man. He was broken with guilt and shame. Mm. He had sinned against Jesus to his face, and it was too much for him to bear.
Yes.
All he can do was weep. All he can do was cry. Peter was no sissy. Peter was no punk. He was a fisherman. By trade, he was a man accustomed to working hard and long hours.
Yes.
Peter was a man's man, yet he cried.
Hmm.
He cried because he let his Lord down. He cried because he had another chance to prove his love and loyalty, but he did the very thing that he said that he would not do.
Yes.
He disowned Jesus. He denied Jesus as his Lord. So Jesus sends the women at the tomb to tell Peter that he is risen because Peter needs to know that Jesus has forgiven him.
Mm.
No other disciple had denied Jesus so openly. No other one needed to hear the message of Jesus' resurrection like Peter. The resurrection of Jesus not only means forgiveness for Peter, but it means forgiveness for you too.
Amen.
You and I have more in common with Peter than we can possibly ever imagine.
Yes, sir.
Just like Peter, you and I have sinned right in Jesus' face.
Mm.
At least Peter only denied him 3 times.
Wow.
If the truth be told, we have denied Jesus many, many more times than that. Every time we force things to go our way, we deny him as Lord.
Wow.
Every time we set out to please ourselves and satisfy our own desire without considering what the Lord would have us to do, we deny him as Lord.
Yes.
Every time we surf the porn internet sites or we snort that powder or we puff on that recreational weed or deliberately mistreat our spouse or someone who's close to us, we deny him as Lord. Oh yeah, we have denied Jesus so many more times than Peter. Yet the message of the cross and resurrection is still the same as it was 2,000 years ago.
Hallelujah.
You are forgiven.
Hallelujah. Thank
you. You are forgiven.
Jesus. Thank you.
In honor of social distancing, give somebody an air high five and say, Jesus forgives me. He does.
Yeah.
He really does. Jesus forgives you, but just like Peter, you need to receive his forgiveness.
Yes.
You need to hear it and accept it in your heart.
Mm.
The same forgiveness that is being extended to Peter is being extended to each and every one of you.
Thank you.
And it's being extended to you in this moment right now.
Mm.
Peter needed to know that Jesus forgives him, and so do you.
Mm.
Peter needs to know that Jesus has not forsaken him. He needs to know that Jesus forgives him. And Peter also needs to know that he has a future with Jesus.
Yes.
As far as Peter was concerned, that was his last chance. He had no idea that he was going to see Jesus again.
Mm.
There was no record of Peter being in the presence of Jesus again on that side of the cross. As far as Peter knew, he had blown it.
Mm-hmm.
He knew it, and he was broken. Can you imagine all the memories that must have flooded Peter's mind? Peter has spent 3 years with Jesus. He walked with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
He talked intimately with Jesus. Peter was there when Jesus fed the 5,000.
Mm-hmm.
Peter was there when Jesus healed the woman of the issue of blood.
Yes.
Peter was there when Jesus cleansed the temple.
Mm-hmm.
He was there when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead.
Yes.
Peter was there on the Mount of Transfiguration when Jesus was glorified. It was Peter who walked on water with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Peter was looking forward to Jesus' coming kingdom.
Yes.
He had left his family. He had left his home. He had left his occupation. He had left his business and his partners, his livelihood, to follow Jesus. And now, where would he go and what will be?
Mm.
Jesus had asked Peter before if he would leave him as some of the other followers had done. And Peter said, "Lord, where shall I go?
Right.
For you have the words of eternal life." What will come of Peter's eternal life now? Where is his future with Jesus? Peter has broken his word and he has denied the Lord. He has denied Jesus as Lord and friend.
Mm.
He has carried around this burden of guilt and shame for 3 days and nights with no hope of restitution, or so he thought.
Hmm.
Jesus sends the women at the tomb to tell Peter the good news that Jesus has risen, because Peter needs to know that he still has a future.
Yes.
With Jesus.
Yes, yes.
He needs to know that he still belongs. He needs to know that he still has a friend who will stick closer than a brother.
Mm.
Jesus wants Peter to know that he is still for him, that he is still in Peter's corner, that Peter is still valuable and still usable.
Yes.
Somebody who has tuned in today needed to hear that truth right there.
Yes, sir.
You are still valuable and you are still usable.
Hallelujah.
By the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You need to know that you have not completely blown it.
Thank you
need
you,
to
Lord.
Know that there is still hope in Jesus Christ for you.
Thank you.
Regardless of your past failures, you still have a future with Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is still for you and not against you.
Mm.
He still wants to beautify your life.
Ooh,
Jesus still wants to infuse your life with meaning.
Mm.
He doesn't care how many false promises you've already made.
Mm.
He doesn't care how many times you've already blown it.
Mm.
Jesus doesn't care how many sins you have committed or how terrible they may have been.
Mm.
He just doesn't care. The message of this day, the resurrection day, is this.
Mm.
That Jesus died because you messed up and you stand in need of forgiveness.
Yes.
And you could desperately use a fresh start.
Hallelujah.
How about it?
Thank you, Lord.
Think about all that you've done. Think about all of the things that you have been through.
Mm.
Jesus knows about everything.
Yes.
He knows about that sexual abuse.
Yes.
He knows about how unclean and dirty you feel.
Mm.
He knows all the wrong that has been done to you. He knows what you have allowed things to be done to you.
Yes.
Doesn't a fresh start sound really good right about now?
Glory to God.
Jesus rose to a new life so that you could have a new life too. Everything new is Jesus' deal for you today.
Glory to
if
God.
Jesus conquered death and the grave, then nothing that has come in your life, nothing that has happened in your life is too difficult for him to overcome.
Praise God.
I stopped by your house this morning to tell you that Jesus has the power to bring beauty out of ashes.
Hallelujah.
I stopped by your house this morning to tell you that Jesus has the power to bring glory out of guilt. I stopped by the house this morning to tell you that Jesus has the power to bring sunshine out of shame. Jesus, and only Jesus, only the resurrected Jesus can do that. He rose up on that third day. The Bible lets us know with all power in his hand.
Power, yes.
And he has the power to turn your life upside down. He has the power to make the crooked way straight.
Yes.
He has the power to clean up what's been dirty and make it like new. Jesus has the power to do everything in your life that you possibly need to be done. He has the power to do that because he conquered the grave and he rose. He has the power to resurrect whatever in your life has been dead. And the question I have for you this resurrection morning is this. Are you ready for a fresh start? Are you ready to start anew? Are you ready for newness of life?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready for a clean state?
Yes.
Are you ready for a reboot? Those of us who like to golf a little bit, and I'm not claiming to be a great golfer, but when I do golf, one of my favorite phrases is mulligan. What is a mulligan? A mulligan is when you hit the golf ball and it goes into the woods and you can't find it. You can call a mulligan and you have a do-over. You can do it all over again. Jesus is ready to give you a mulligan today. He's
Hallelujah.
Ready to give you a do-over.
Hallelujah.
He's ready to give you a fresh start. He's ready to start things anew in your life. And the question is, are you ready for a fresh start?
Hallelujah.
Listen, the epilogue of the coronavirus epidemic will be meaningful if one thing happens. And that one thing is not the reboot of the economy.
All right.
That one thing is not to get back to life as normal.
All right.
It is not to be able to do the same old, same old. It will be meaningful if people recalibrate their priorities by embracing the resurrected Jesus as Savior and Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And guess what? You don't have to wait till the pandemic ends to embrace the resurrected Jesus as Savior and Lord. You can do that right here, right now, in this moment.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Jesus stands with outstretched arms, waiting for you to embrace him. He's got mad love in his heart for you.
Praise you, God.
All he's ever wanted is for you to be in relationship with him. It's for you to turn over your life to him. All he's ever wanted is to build a forever family of himself. And his family will not be complete without you. He loved you enough to go to the cross and to die for the sins that you've committed.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus wants to be in relationship with you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
And you can get into relationship with him right now. All you have to do is to bow the will of your life and humbly just say something like this to him. Lord Jesus, I surrender all to you. I heard what the pastor said. You died on the cross for my sins. And Lord, I realize now that I need you. And I want to be part of your forever family. So Lord, come into my heart and my life. Become the leader of my life. As you are the Savior of my life. And if you say something like that to him, he will do just that. And he'll come in. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for this moment. I thank you for this opportunity, Lord. I thank you, Father, for all of those, God, who are sincerely saying in their hearts right now that they want a relationship with you.
Yes,
Lord.
What better day for them to give their life to you but on Resurrection Day, the day where you sealed our salvation for us. And so, Lord, I pray that before this message is finished, God, or before the day is over,
yes,
that they would have a little talk with Jesus to be able to get their eternal destination settled and allow you, Jesus, to come into their heart to be what you are already claimed to be, Savior and Lord.
Yes.
In Jesus' name,
in Jesus'
I pray.
Name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so very much for giving some time and attention to the Lord on this day and on this message. We want to enter into our time of communion. We want to just give you a little opportunity as my wife comes to get yourself prepared, to pull out your elements. I'm going to read a passage of scripture. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and the man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house he enters, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." Jesus instructed his disciples to go and to a man who owned a house, and there will be a large upper room in which they will be able to make preparations for the Passover. That large upper room symbolizes really our hearts. We are to make preparations in our hearts to be able to receive the Passover lamb, who is Jesus Christ. We're to make preparations into our heart, and it should be the largest room in our hearts. And that place should be reserved for Jesus. And so as we enter into this time of communion, which is our common union, the blood of Christ is our common union, we are reminded of not only the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, but it is a look forward to his coming again.
Yes.
It is a look back and is a look forward. And so we're going to pray God's blessing over the elements, and then we're going to partake of the communion. Father, we thank you for this moment, God, in the life of every believer. We thank you, Lord, that as we come to you, Father, we are blessed by the sacrifice of Jesus.
Yes.
We're blessed by the 3 days he spent in the grave. And we're blessed by his resurrection on the third day morning.
Yes.
And so, Lord, just as Jesus did on that night, Lord, we gather, God, for this ceremony, Lord. We pray your blessings upon the bread.
Yes.
The bread represents our Lord's body. Mm. We pray, God, that as we partake of it, it will have its spiritual significance that it was intended to do a long time ago.
Yes.
We pray, God, that you would change it from its natural to its spiritual. Mm. And as we partake of the fruit of the vine, Lord, the cup, which was the ushering in of the new covenant, the new testament,
yes,
we pray, God, that it will be meaningful for us, Lord, because the blood of Jesus never loses its power. And so we thank you for the cleansing and the healing that the cup represents. Mm. And so, Lord, now be thou glorified.
Yes.
In our remembrance and our look forward, in Jesus' name,
Jesus
we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, broken on Calvary for the remission of sins. This is the body and the blood of the, this is the body of the Lord. Let us eat together. blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed on Calvary for the remission of sins, represents our new covenant, the forgiveness in the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
Come on, let's drink together. Thank you, Lord, for the blood.
Thank you, Lord, for the blood.
Thank you, Lord, for the blood.
Yes.
This concludes our worship experience on this Resurrection Day. We look forward to being with you again.
Yes.
Next week at this time.
Yes.
In between now and then, stay safe, be well, pray often, and let us put our trust in the one to whom we know we can trust,
Amen.
Which is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And we'll see you later.
God bless you. You can give via text by sending a text to SJCBC to 73256. You will receive a text message in return with the given link. Or if you are a member of Realm, you can go online through the Realm Connect application on your tablet or your phone. Or you can send your gifts by bill pay from your bank or by mailing in a check to St. John's Community Baptist Church, P.O. Box 2448, Newark, New Jersey, 07114.